Good morning. A few announcements before we begin our worship. We are still accepting donations for the hurricane relief efforts. There's an insert in your bulletin, and it's included on one side, the items needed for the personal hygiene kits, as well as gift cards. The cleanup continues, and now there's some cleanup from Milton, so anything you can give to help our friends down south would be greatly appreciated. We are sending them out as we fill boxes, and we will continue to collect next week. This past week, our dear sister in Christ, Marlene O'Malley, passed away, and we will have a celebration of her life and her new life as erected daughter of the King. This Saturday, visitation with the family will be at 10 a.m. here at St. Matthew, and the service will begin at noon. We also have Saturday evening family fun night at the movies. It's on the back side of your insert. So if you have kids, grandkids, you just want to come have fun, popcorn, a movie, please indicate your interest on the Connect card and vote for a movie. It's going to be two fun movies to pick from, Christopher Robin or Migration, so please indicate that. And you'll also want to note the food packing event is next Sunday in the gym at 11:30. So if you're interested in any of that, please fill it out on your Connect card. We also have coming up in the winter an opportunity to serve with the rotating homeless shelter. Several years St. Matthew has done that. We have not done that in the past 2 years. However, they are offering that opportunity to homeless folks in Harford County again, and we are trying to determine if there is enough interest for St. Matthew to host it. We need about 20 people to host this. Some people will host the night and they will spend time with the guests. Other people will prepare meals, and other people will bring designated items that we need, such as coffee and refreshments and games and things. So if you're interested in that, please sign up on the Connect card so we can determine if we have enough help. And if you have questions, please do not hesitate to email the church office. And I think that's all I have, Pastor Dave. Oh, well, or Pastor Paul. Who's leading?
We look alike.
You yes. Look alike. You're getting closer.
On that note, I invite you to rise as we begin our worship. And we begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We gather to hear God's word, for his word reveals his kindness, mercy, and love.
We gather with thanksgiving to praise and worship him.
We gather in Christ, who washed away our sin, giving us new life.
We gather with all our joys.
We gather in the Spirit, poured out again upon us through Christ Jesus our Lord.
We rejoice in his grace and trust in his promises.
Let us humbly approach God's throne of grace, where forgiveness, salvation, and eternal life are found. Merciful and holy God,
we confess that we often seek to serve only ourselves and neglect to care for the needs of others. We have ignored your call to be merciful, loving, and generous. We have tried to find meaning in this world, turning our minds and hearts away from you. Forgive us, O God. Transform us to receive and reflect your compassion, generosity, and love.
God hears the cries of all who call out in need, and through the death and resurrection of his Son, he has made us his own. We are home in God's mercy now and forever. Your sins have been paid for by Christ. They are forgiven.
Amen. Amen.
Let's greet one another with the peace of God.
God's peace, right?
God's peace, man. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace.
Godspeed, shimmy.
That's great, Godspeed. Salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Lord, most high.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, you have adopted us into your family and made us partakers of your grace. Increase in us your gift of faith and encourage us when we are wearied by the changes and challenges of this world. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Our Old Promise reading comes to us from the book of Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, beginning at the first verse. Who has believed our message? To whom has the Lord revealed his powerful arm? My servant grew up in the Lord's presence like a tender green shoot, like a root in dry ground. There was nothing beautiful or majestic about his appearance. Nothing to attract us to him. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. It was our weakness he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so that we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short in midstream. But he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. This is the word of the Lord.
Jesus.
Our new promise reading comes to us from the book of Titus, the third chapter, beginning at the third verse. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. When the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, who he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs, having the hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy saying, and I want you to stress these things so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves to doing what is good. These things are excellent and profitable for everyone. This is the word of the Lord.
We rise for the gospel acclamation.
Gospel according to St. Luke, the 23rd chapter. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said he saved others, let him save himself if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one. The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you're the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." And then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "Truly, I tell you, today, you will be with me in paradise." It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, for the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated for our sermon hymn.
Thank you.
promised you that by the end of this sermon series, I will have waited for the video and say I did it. So, it's good to be with you all. I make my beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. 6 weeks ago, we began this sermon series on prayer by noting that the gospel writer Luke emphasized Jesus' prayer time more than any of the other gospel writers. We noted numerous instances that found the Lord to be in prayer, always seeking to be in fellowship with his Father. This isn't an easy concept to grasp. Jesus, who is true God, the second person of the Holy Trinity, Jesus, who John says in the beginning was with God and who was God, yet on his knees praying to his Father because he was also true man. True man in that he ate, he slept, he wept. And it was in that humanity, in his humility, that he was subservient to the Father's purpose and will. And that purpose and will was to send Jesus down here to earth to pay the price for our sins by dying on that cross. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, would you help us to fix our eyes upon Jesus and his finished work on the cross? That finished work that brings about the forgiveness of sins, that brings about spiritual treasure that we cannot earn, and a rest that we cannot otherwise experience. Lord, we pray in his name, amen. We also noted that both the first and the last weeks of this sermon series, we would be focusing on actual prayers by Jesus. In between those 4 weeks, we were left sort of to our own imaginations as to whom Jesus prayed for and for what Jesus prayed for, given the context of each prayer. We heard from Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, "Father, take this cup, but not my will, your will be done." But now, this morning, we hear Jesus pray from the cross, where our Lord actually prays two times, once in verse 34 and once in verse 46. And in between, there's a lot of physical pain and anguish. There's also the loneliness of hell itself, if only for a little while, because on the cross is where he will lose fellowship with his Father. And why? Well, the prophet Habakkuk says of God, "Your eyes are too pure to look on evil." And so when Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin for our sake on that cross, there was a separation between the Father and the Son. So now we see Jesus looking down from the cross upon a scene that must have been most distressing to him, and yet he prays, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The first prayer. So here we know what Jesus was praying for. He was praying for forgiveness, but for whom was he praying? So I want you to take a minute while you're in your seats. You can do this by yourself or share with someone next to you. Who do you think Jesus was praying for when he was on that cross asking for forgiveness? So take a minute and either contemplate yourself or share with somebody else. Well, I feel certainly that Jesus would have prayed for the soldiers, The soldiers who had mocked him and beaten him at first, then had spat in his face and put a crown of thorns on his head, then they got around to actually doing the dirty work of hanging him on a cross, nailing his hands and feet. I'm going to show you a painting now. This is Giacchino Acerte's Division of Christ. I chose this, you can turn down the lights, right, if you don't mind. I chose this particular painting because it shows the contempt on the faces of the soldiers mocking Jesus prior to his crucifixion. It's probably hard for you to see, but if you look closely, you can see they're contorted and they're vile faces. And then we see Jesus, who seems to have surrendered to his divine purpose. It seems to me that these soldiers were more than just doing their job. They seem to be having sheer delight in what they're doing. Father, forgive them, for they are so callous that they've become immune to human suffering. Perhaps Jesus was also praying for the religious leaders of the day. These religious leaders who had become so blinded by their sense of legalistic ways and by their spiritual arrogance that they literally failed to recognize Jesus standing before them, failing to recognize that they had the Son of God in their midst. And instead of recognizing him, they accuse him and they convict him. This painting that I'm going to show you next is William Brassey Hole's painting titled Jesus Brought Before Caiaphas and the Council. These are the religious leaders. You can turn down the lights here again so we can see this a little better. This painting depicts Jesus standing serenely before these religious leaders, who in contrast seem to be very agitated and perturbed. In addition, we see Jesus, who's clothed in white, and the religious leaders are dressed in colors that are darker. So why do you think this artist chose to put Jesus in the middle and dress him in white? Anybody? Yeah. Pure. Yep. You think of anything else? I think purity and innocence is definitely what the artist would have had in mind. Father, forgive them for their pride, which has blinded them to the truth. The religious leaders who knew the scriptures inside and out, they could quote them, but they failed to see that the scriptures pointed to Jesus, who was standing right there before their very eyes. Rather than recognizing Jesus, they deny him. Recall what Jesus had said to these religious leaders on a prior occasion back in John 5 when he said, "You search the scriptures because in them you think you have eternal life, but it is them, the scriptures, that bear witness of me." We'll move on. Perhaps Jesus' plea for forgiveness was also meant for Pilate, the Roman governor, who ignored his own convictions, and men, you can identify with this, ignored his wife's counsel, and gave in to the pleas of this angry mob. The next painting, Pilate, who condemned Jesus to be crucified, not because he believed Jesus was guilty, but face it, he did it for his own political career. This is Munkacs' Christ Before Pilate, painted, you can hit the lights again, painted in 1881. And I think it does a really good job of showing a victorious Jesus. Again, he's in his radiant whiteness here. He stands in front of his enemies and what appears to be, if you could look closer, a very hesitant Pilate. Pilate hesitant because he's juggling doing what's right and juggling the fears that he has of the results of doing the right thing. Father, forgive him for denying the truth out of fear of what the results might bring. Surely Jesus prayed for the crowds too. The common people who had listened to the religious leaders and were stirred up shouted out to Pilate, "His blood is on us and our children." Can you imagine? The crowds were also in front of Jesus while he was on the cross, hurling insults at him. And now what about us? Did you think about us as far as who Jesus prayed for? For he is on that cross in part because of us. For we are sinners. Sometimes we know it, and then sometimes we act like we don't. I can certainly identify with the Apostle Paul in Romans 7, "For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want to do, I keep on doing. Who will deliver me from this body of death?" Well, as we know, this was the purpose of Jesus dying on the cross, to take our sins, all of our sins, plus the sins of the whole world, so that they could be laid on his bruised and bloodied back. And know that this prayer of Jesus doesn't just talk about forgiveness, it proclaims forgiveness. Finally, after 6 hours on this one Black Friday, the business of saving the world from its sin was just about completed. Our Lord had accomplished all that he was sent to do. He had lived a perfect life. He had gone to the cross in place of us, that being the greatest act of self-sacrifice and love that the universe had ever seen. And now all that was left for him to do was to breathe his last. And like most people in that last grasp of life, he knew it would be soon. For every other person, death is inevitable. You see, humans are mortal, but Jesus is the eternal Son of God. God and man. Jesus' death was voluntary. It was a willing offering. Never think that Jesus' life was taken from him. Rather, he gave it up. "The reason the Father loves me," Jesus had said on a prior occasion, "is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord." You see, Jesus could have saved himself, but he chose to save you instead. And me. Darkness had fallen over the land now for 3 hours. The sun had stopped shining in the middle of the day when Jesus speaks these final words. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And then Luke tells us he died. Jesus breathed his last. Now, when I had said that all that was left for Jesus to do was to take his last breath, I didn't mean to imply that that's an easy thing to do, our last breath. Do you know the average person at rest, not exercising, takes about 16 breaths a minute? That's 960 breaths every hour. If a person lives to be 80 years old, they breathe over 672 million times. And they're all important. And then there's the last breath. For Jesus, it was immediately after he cried out, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit," and then his last breath, and then his human death. But his death was just not the end of his life, but it was the accomplishment of his mission. Now it had become finished business, done, debt paid, forgiveness of sins, check, eternal life, check. But let me ask you a question this morning. Is this finished business for you? Jesus dying on the cross? Or do you think you still need to do something else, no matter how small it may be? But understand this. If it is true that Jesus Christ has finished paying the debt for your sin, then you cannot add anything to what he has already done. You cannot refinish the finished work of Jesus. There are things in life that you can destroy by adding to them. Take the most famous painting in the entire world, the Mona Lisa. Now, just suppose that I was able to get this painting from the Louvre in Paris, and I would have it in my hands right here, and I got my own paintbrush out, and I decided I was going to add to it. Does anybody think I would add to its beauty? How many think that I would ruin it? No, you guys are pretty kind. You must think I'm a pretty good artist. I'll give you more of an everyday example. My mother made chicken corn soup in the summer. Anybody here from Pennsylvania Dutch background? Yeah. I love this soup, and my mother made it just right, and yet this one night I decided to take the salt shaker to it and add. I ruined it. I couldn't even swallow that first bite. See, the finished work of Christ is like that. To add to it is to disfigure it. It's to deface it. It's to destroy it altogether. There is absolutely nothing you can do to what Jesus Christ has accomplished for you on that cross. There is no penance you can do. There is no good work you can perform. There is no punishment that you can endure besides what Jesus has done. You will know a cult like the Mormons because they will spin a different message, one which adds something to the finished work of Jesus. A cult will make sure that you have to obey certain rules. They'll stress moral efforts and good works in order to gain entry into heaven. But as a Christian, any good work we do doesn't add or contribute to our salvation. Instead, whatever good works we do, they're a result of our salvation. The final prayer of Jesus is good and appropriate, not just when we're about to die, but also as we awaken every morning with the gift of life. Father, on this day, into your hands I commit my spirit. You see, it's a prayer of surrendering like we talked about last week. It's a prayer of giving up your own agendas and your own will to God each morning. Father, into your hands I commit this day. I commit this busy schedule. I commit these worries. Father, into your hands I commit my dreams and my hopes. You see, this prayer is ultimately a prayer of faith. It's a prayer that expresses trust in a loving and merciful God. It is a prayer for the living as well as the dying. It is a prayer that trusts in the finished business of Jesus. Amen?
Amen. I invite us to rise and confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate.
he suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We join in the prayer of the church. The response is, hear our prayer. We pray. Creating and redeeming God, we rejoice in the gift of your Son, whose saving work continues in us today. We give you thanks for the new life you place in our hearts and for your constant and abiding presence in our lives. Faithful God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the church, for steadfast efforts to build up the body of Christ in the world. Make us a beacon of compassion and love for all people, that they may recognize your good news. Faithful God,
hear our prayer.
Guide the nations, O God. Grant that leaders, both here and abroad, work for peace and justice in the midst of violence and destruction. Restore order and safety to war-torn places in the world. Provide aid and refuge and relief for those facing conflict and bloodshed. Faithful God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those affected by recent hurricanes and other natural disasters. Give them strength and courage to endure. May your love and grace bring them hope. Provide aid, resources, and support for those displaced from their homes or families. Grant wisdom and safety to all responders and volunteers. Faithful God,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our loved ones who are struggling with illness and personal difficulties. Send your healing and peace and raise up compassionate caregivers. We pray for all those who mourn. We pray for the family of Marlene O'Malley, that they feel your comfort, your strength, your Holy Spirit, with that sure knowledge of the victory of the resurrection to eternal life. On this Day of Atonement, we celebrate that he has achieved that perfect atonement, that we may be at one forever with you. Be present with all who are afraid and anxious or grieving. Faithful God,
hear our prayer.
Strengthen families and relationships everywhere with unity, peace, and forgiveness. Heal divisions, restore trust, and bless them with love and grace. Faithful God,
hear our prayer.
Redeeming God, hear our prayers and deliver your healing, strength, and divine love to all for whom we pray. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
We continue our worship with the service of the sacrament. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and beneficial that we should always give thanks and praise to you, Holy Father, Almighty God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who redeemed us by his blood, so that we would receive the gift of salvation and everlasting life. Keep us mindful of the abundant life we have in Christ, who gives our lives true meaning and purpose. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Father, mighty Lord. All things are yours, and without you nothing was made. Graciously you provide for all our needs, and lovingly you invite us to come to your table of grace. Gathered in the name and remembrance of Jesus, we ask you, dear Father, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and sustain us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the same manner also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the remission of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion and your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us pray. O gracious Lord, we give thanks that you have fed and nourished us upon your word. Keep us in this grace that we may not trust in ourselves but in Christ alone. May your Spirit guide us to follow you, trust in your word, and to love you and others with the perfect love of Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Pastor Dave, our next steps.
Well, Pastor Paul was on the fence about this because, you know, when you have a perfect sermon, you know, you don't really want to add anything. No, but yeah. There's nothing we can do to earn or contribute to our salvation. Our good works follow our salvation. Christ has freed us up to love our neighbors and to help others. We are not saved by our works, but we're saved for our good works. Amen.
Amen. And receive now the benediction of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Amen.
Thanks be to God.